Doctor Who, The Aztecs, by John Lucarotti. Read by William Russell. Chapter 1, Coiled Serpent. The TARDIS has materialised, the Doctor announced authoritatively. Where? Asked Susan, the Doctor's 15-year-old granddaughter. The Doctor moved around the central control deck of the spacecraft to the digital time-place orientation printout and pressed the appropriate button. Nothing happened. Well? Susan arched her eyebrows. Chesterton, hand me a screwdriver, the Doctor said testily. Ian took one from the toolkit and gave it to the Doctor, remarking that with any luck, they were on Earth during the 1980s in an aerospace factory where the TARDIS could be thoroughly overhauled. The Doctor was not amused and began furiously unscrewing the front panel of the printout. We could always stick our heads outside the door and look, Barbara Wright suggested. And be devoured by a dinosaur? Or dictated to by a Dalek, perhaps? Ian added. Let's check the atmosphere, Susan said. Good idea. Ian turned to the Doctor. May I? The only reply was a grunt, which Ian took to mean yes. So he switched on the atmospheric sensor. A display screen gave a breakdown of the gases outside. Ian studied it for a moment and then said that it appeared they were on Earth. But the air was stale. Stale? Susan echoed. Breathable but musty. Then we can take a peek, said Barbara. Coming with me? She asked Susan. When Susan asked the Doctor if she could go, he waved one hand rather vaguely at her and told Ian to help him to remove the panel. When it was off, the Doctor began poking at the electronics with his screwdriver, making the 28-year-old scientist wince with despair. Cautiously, Susan and Barbara opened the door and peered out. Apart from the light inside the TARDIS, they were in total darkness. Where do you think we are? Susan whispered. Barbara shook her head. But as the light from the TARDIS diffused and their eyes became accustomed to the gloom, they stepped outside and looked around. They were in a large tomb. And in the centre was a raised stone slab on which lay a superbly cloaked skeleton with a magnificent gold mask covering the skull. On the floor, around the slab, were earthen bowls and jugs, as well as ornaments, statuettes, bracelets, earrings and brooches, all of them made of jade. But it was the cloak, geometrically woven with silver and golden threads, and the superb mask that fascinated Barbara. Look at that, Susan, she murmured. I am. Susan shuddered with a sense of foreboding, anticipating the evil to come. It's an Aztec mask of Quetzalcoatl, the sun god, who was driven into exile by Huitzilopochtli, the god of darkness. Barbara looked down at the skeleton again. He must have been a high priest. Beside one skeletal hand was an oblong rod of carved jade with six beaded threads of silver, each about 6 inches long, attached to one end. Barbara picked it up and smiled. Do you know what this was? No. His personal fly swatter. Susan giggled. Since the Aztecs were Mexicans, the TARDIS must definitely be on Earth. But what year is it? She asked. I can tell you when he died, Barbara pointed to the object strewn on the floor. About 1430? These things all come from the Aztecs' early period. She picked up a gold bracelet shaped like a coiled snake that lay on the slab above the mask and turned it over in her hands. This indicates that after he died, he was revered as a god. You really know your subject, Susan exclaimed. Barbara smiled and admitted that when she was at university, she had been particularly interested in the Aztec Indians and their civilization. What little I know about them doesn't make me feel very well disposed towards them, Susan replied with a grimace. They used to cut out people's hearts while they were still alive, didn't they? Barbara picked up the razor-sharp knife, hewn from stone, which lay at the skeleton's feet. They did. They did it with this, she said. It's called an obsidian knife. But there was another side to their nature, a highly civilized one. The Spanish didn't think so when they came here. Fernando Cortes and his conquistadores saw only wealth for themselves and barbarous acts of savagery by the Aztecs, Barbara replied. That was the tragedy of the race. Their civilization was completely destroyed, the good as well as the bad. Barbara put down the knife and picked up the bracelet again. The Spanish landed in the early 1500s, didn't they? Susan asked. 1519, to be exact. Still holding the bracelet, Barbara pointed to the wall behind the head of the slab. A coloured fresco depicting an eagle clutching a coiled snake in its claws, surrounded by warriors in loincloths, cloaks, plumed headdresses and sandals, who held shields, spears and short swords slung from their hips. From their mouths came bubbles filled with hieroglyphs. Barbara studied the fresco, and almost without realizing it, slipped the bracelet onto her wrist. Just like cartoon strips, Susan remarked. But they're all the same. What does it mean? That the warriors will protect the high priest's spirit until he rejoins his people. Did the Aztecs believe in reincarnation then? Susan sounded surprised. Definitely. Barbara moved closer to the wall. This painting has hardly faded at all. She touched the mural, then quickly withdrew her hand. What's the matter? Susan asked. Maybe my imagination, Barbara replied. But I think the wall moved when I touched it. Let's both push it and see. They put their hands to the wall and began to push. The wall swung slowly outwards and upwards. Light trickled into the tomb and then flooded in as the wall rose higher and higher. Both of them blinked as their eyes adjusted to its intensity. This tomb is part of a temple, Barbara whispered. Hadn't we better go back to the TARDIS? Susan asked nervously. No, it's all right, Barbara replied. There's no one here. I think I'd better fetch Grandfather and Ian anyway, Susan said, and ran back into the tomb. Barbara left the tomb, walked to the center of the temple, and looked around. The temple itself was not large, about 50 square feet. Three sides were painted in white and blood red, decorated with sculpted skulls and coiled snakes, and hung with elaborately woven brocade curtains. The fourth side opened onto a terrace, in the center of which stood the sacrificial altar. Barbara shivered involuntarily as she approached the terrace to see what lay beyond it. Woman!
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.